praise the Lord. Welcome, glad that you're here. Please take time to sign the friendship pass so we can make record of your presence here. If you're visiting with us today, we want to know who you are and send you a note this week welcoming you. And if you are visiting, first time, second time, we have a gift for you out in the narthex or breezeway to your left, coffee mug with some items in it. So please take one. This is just for visitors, not church members yet. A few prayer concerns this morning. Got word, actually, I received word last night. Molly Feenster Green. Many of you know Molly Feenster Green, I'm sure. She died this week while trying to save her grandchild who was caught up in a riptide. So please remember her in your prayers. Also understand that I think they lost a child around 25 years ago, I believe, 30 years ago as well. So please lift that family up in your prayers. Bonnie Wilford still in the hospital. She's going to have surgery Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. It is serious surgery to remove her colon. So please lift her up in your prayer. She's been in the hospital now for a long time. I visited with her yesterday. Her spirits are high, but this is a very serious surgery. Alan Smith is in the hospital, still battling with his heart problems as well as diabetes. He's been in room 4403. Our youth will be returning from their retreat this afternoon, late afternoon, or the evening. They've had a wonderful time. Also, please notice all the other announcements in the bulletin. Organizational meeting for a mission trip to Guatemala has been scheduled for this week, July 23rd at 5:30 in the mission room. Also, note Rally Day, we turn to two services. That is just 2 weeks away. So there's one more Sunday at 10 o'clock worship. And also note the summer snack drive for autism therapists. I have to say, it's kind of all of our resources in this church. We have only one box filled. This church should be filling 10 boxes in the breezeway. So that's a little guilt trip on you. But we can do better than one box of items for the autism group. Any other announcements or concerns or celebrations of the church? May we prepare to worship God.
Thank you. from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. Amen.
Thought that was more important than listening to Jesus. What's more important? listening to Jesus or cleaning the house? Yeah, listening to Jesus. So Martha forgot the most important thing, right? I don't want you to forget the most important thing. The most important thing is what? The hamburger and the Happy Meal? No, it's what? It's listening to Jesus, right? It is. So y'all remember that. Let's say a prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the important things in life, like these hamburgers. We pray that those who are eating french fries will not get sick today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Good luck, Heather. We continue our sermon series on the seven deadly sins this morning. This morning's topic is sloth. That should excite everyone. Even my wife asked me as I was leaving home this morning, am I in the sermon this morning? Why would you be in the sermon this morning, sweetheart? Sloth. Next week's topic is wrath, and I'm sure I'll catch that from my wife next week. Please turn with me to our scripture. First of all, from Proverbs, chapter 6, 9, 10, and 11, and then Revelation. Proverbs 6, beginning with verse 9. How long will you lie down, O sluggard? When will you arise from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. And your poverty will become like a vagabond, and your need like an armed man. Now from Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 through 16, not 15 through 16. And the angel of the Lord in Laodicea, right? The Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, says this: I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I would that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. This is indeed the word of God. May we pray. Precious God, we pause now to hear your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so we will hear and faithfully respond. Oh, amen. A stranger passing along a road and uncertain of his way, saw a shepherd lad lying by the roadside while the sheep grazed in pastures. And approaching the boy, the stranger asked the way. The boy, scarcely looking up, stretched out his hand nonchalantly and said, "That way." The stranger thanked him, but said, "Now, laddie, if you can show me anything lazier than that, I will give you a shilling." And without even looking up, the lad said, "Put it in my pocket." Personnel manager rejected a job applicant because the firm was overstaffed. But the would-be employee persisted, "But please, please, a little bit of work I do won't even be noticed." Sloth. Of all the deadly seven sins, surely sloth is the lightweight, right? Surely the lightweight. Sloth, a deadly sin. When it comes to the other six, we get it, perhaps. We know that pride goes what before a fall? We know anger too often leads to violence. We know that lust destroys from the inside out, and that envy, yes, envy put Jesus on the cross. We even get that gluttony can lead to what? Premature death. But has anyone ever died from taking it easy? I'm pretty sure the coroner's report never reads cause of death, too many naps. Sloth may not get you to the top of the ladder, but is sloth really that bad? Think about it. Is it really that bad? Sloth seems to be the least deadly and the least relevant of all the seven deadly sins. Yet we all procrastinate, right? We do. We all daydream. We all run late for appointments. Or we just miss them entirely. We fritter away whole evenings in front of the TV. We spend too much time on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Pinterest, or whatever our web addictions happen to be. We intend for things to happen that we never actually start.
We start things that we never actually finish. We end up neglecting God or people because our laziness is a big thing. Because of our laziness or distraction. Maybe that's why the Bible takes sloth so seriously. We just read in Proverbs, "How long will you lie there, you sluggard?" Great words, right? When will you get up from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber. Sloth is insidious. It creeps into your life. It whispers that you might as well do it tomorrow. But nobody will do it if you cut corners here and there to save yourself some time, some trouble. That the world will be the same in 100 years now as it is right now, no matter what you do. So why do anything? Sloth says, don't strain yourself. What's the big hurry? And just give me 5 more minutes. Sloth also hits the snooze alarm, right? It hits the remote control and hits the road when the going gets tough. Sloth cheats on exams. It drinks straight from the milk carton and then puts the carton back into the refrigerator. It leaves exactly 2 sheets on the toilet roll so that it will have to be replaced by the next poor soul who finds out too late that the remaining paper is nothing more than a mirage. Sloth does slightly less than the right thing. It doesn't bother returning something to the lost and found, but pockets it instead. It doesn't tell the clerk that he's been undercharged. Sloth has never, ever written a thank you note, sent a birthday card on time, or entertained angels. All of this takes way too much effort. Sloth never says do today what you can put off until tomorrow. Sloth says never do something that has the risk of failure. Sloth says let George do it, or Sam do it, or someone else. Sloth says just don't get involved with it. Sloth is apathy, the sin of not caring. That's what it is, the sin of not caring. So the angel of the Lord says to the church at Laodicea, I know your deeds, that you're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were neither one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. Not hot enough to be for it, not cold enough to be against it. Just lukewarm, wallowing in your own riches like you don't have a care in the world. Ignorant to the fact that you are spiritually poor, blind, and naked. So, repent. Strong words, right? Think about that. Strong words. Convicting words for people who never did anything wrong, but also never bothered to do anything right. The problem is that they aren't, that they haven't done much of anything except to rejoice in what they have and live their isolated lives. Sloth. Have you ever seen it? I see it all the time. I see it all around. You don't have to look very far to see it. I see it in preachers' gatherings where eyes are glazed over in pastors who are just going through the motions. Just going through the motions week after week after week. These called people of God who no longer shake with the sword of scriptures or shiver in their shoes when asked to proclaim the gospel. These people are just lazy. They no longer get nervous when they stand in the pulpit. They're just doing their job. A scripture says, and I believe this, and I would agree with it, is that I've never once feared the devil. I haven't. I've never once feared the devil, but I tremble every time I stand in the pulpit. I do. Every time I stand in the pulpit, I tremble. And when I stop trembling, that's when I stop preaching. I also see sloth in employees who quit investing a long time ago and are simply putting in their time until retirement. I see it in teenagers and adults who slump down in their pews on Sunday mornings, announcing by their body language they are not going to be moved by anything Owen says today. I'm just not going to care about anything he says. I'm going to pretend as if I'm listening. Sloth. History has called it a deadly sin. Sloth is laziness. You know, Jesus told a story about a man who had one talent. You know that story, right? Among the three men, he was a one talent man. He was not the brightest, the richest, or the most capable of the clan, but he did have one talent. He did have something. Because he was afraid, insecure, and threatened by the authority of the boss, he hid his talent in the ground. And when called to accountability, he tried to blame his lack of interest on the harshness of the master. But the master will have none of his excuses, right? The master called him what? Wicked, lazy servant. As he snatches what little the servant has out of his hands, give it to the one who has 10. Harsh? Yes. Sloth, apathy, laziness is a sin. And it is primarily a sin against God. And I believe it calls for a very extreme makeover, a spiritual makeover. Calls for an infusion of what I believe we call spiritual passion. That's the cure for sloth. Spiritual passion. Passion, that's a great word, right? I believe it is. That is what we need. Passionate people. Passionate people have fervor. They have fire. They have zeal. They're excited. They're focused. They're enthusiastic. Devoted to some cause, and you can see it in their eyes and notice it in their steps. They're still doing what they're called to do. At the end of World War II, you've heard this story perhaps, Robert Woodruff, the president of Coca-Cola Company from 1923 to 1955, had a mission. He said, in my generation, it is my desire that everyone in the world have a taste of Coca-Cola. And with a vision and dedication rarely matched in corporate American culture, Woodruff and his colleagues spanned the globe with their sugar drink. Now, why is it all right for people to feel that passionate about a soft drink, but feel nothing about taking Christ to the world? Are there no people who seek meaning and purpose for their lives? Are there no families in crisis that need Christ's love and understanding? Are there no young people at risk because their lives lack a solid spiritual and moral foundation? St. Paul had a passion, right? He was on a mission. His mission was to win as many people as possible to Jesus Christ. What's your mission? Just go through the motions. William Lloyd Garrison was the greatest abolitionist this country has ever known. He was the publisher of a newspaper called The Liberator, an anti-slavery publication. Garrison was a very angry man, angry with indignation caused by the unbelief. unbelievably inhumane treatment of many of the slaves. He hated slavery with everything that was in him. One day, his best friend, Samuel May, tried to calm him down. He said to Garrison, "Oh, my friend, try to moderate your indignation and keep more cool, please. Why, you are on fire." And Garrison replied, "Brother May, I have need to be on fire. I have mountains of ice around me to melt." Well, the only way any of us can melt mountains of ice is to be on fire. And if you believe we have no mountains of ice to melt, you live on a different planet. I'm afraid there are a few people of Christ today who are truly on fire. The only way Christ can use any of us is when we are driven by a great passion. When we feel or hear his voice within our heart, showing us a great cause that needs to be championed. You know, nothing is accomplished in this world by people who have no passion. Nothing. That's one reason we need God in our hearts as well as on our lips. You know, the word passion comes from the Latin word meaning suffer or to suffer with. And you can answer your phone now if you'd like. You know, I handle sloth by learning to suffer with another. To suffer with another. Think about that for a moment. To suffer with another. That's what passion means. We call the suffering of Christ in the period following the Lord's Supper through the crucifixion, we call that what? The passion of Christ, right? Martin Luther said, "The passion of Christ should never be acted out in words or in plays. It should be embodied in real life." Is it acted out in our real life? What are you passionate about? Here's my list. I'm passionate about golf, even though I don't play as much as I used to. I'm still passionate about it. And as I was walking into the pulpit, Sean Lowry was leading by 5 or 6, I believe, as he was making a turn in Northern Ireland. I'm passionate about travel, hunting the mountains of North Carolina. I'm passionate about yard work. You could probably create a similar list of passions. What are your interests? What are the interests that capture your attention and the activities that fill your free time? What are the things that you talk about, things that really matter? You know, as I look at my list, though, I'm struck by the fact that these things are all temporal things that give me pleasure. As much as I love playing golf and working in the yard, I also know that there are more important things to focus on, things that move me to action. So here's another list of my passions, believe it or not. I'm passionate about God and my relationship with my Creator. I was called to ministry over 30 years ago. My life has never been the same. I'm passionate about what I do. I also love hearing stories about changed lives. Just this week on Facebook, I told you I'm back on that silly thing that is very self-serving, but occasionally I hear some good news. Someone in a former church messaged me, someone I hadn't thought about in 25 years, said, "Olin, I just wanted to tell you, your sermons changed my life." That's amazing. I never thought anyone was listening. That's amazing. I'm passionate, believe it or not, sweetheart, and Henry in the balcony. I'm passionate about being a husband and a father. And believe it or not, I'm passionate about being a grandfather. As Jim and I celebrated our anniversary this past June, I realized that each year is sweeter than the one before. I'm proud of our two wonderful grandchildren, Emma and Aubrey. I'm passionate about being part of this organization. I'm passionate about being a minister of this church, a church that I've helping to build godly families. It's a time when so many people are struggling with their family relationships. I believe God has raised up this ministry at First Presbyterian Church to provide some answers. Now, my first list of passions consists of my interests. The second list is all the things about God. And these are the passions I want to define my life. What are you passionate about? What captures your allegiance and inspires your passion? You probably could develop an initial list, just as I did, of your interests and hobbies and great joys, the things you love doing. But beyond that, what are the most important things in your life? If you stripped away all the items on your initial list, what would remain? What are the passions that move you to action? Maybe you could answer these questions about your interests, but some of you may have given little thought to your passions. Here are a few questions that perhaps spark some fresh thinking. Are you satisfied with your passion for God and your relationship with Him? Are you? What needs to be changed so that you can become more focused in living for Christ? How do you want to be remembered once you're gone? Because people will remember you. What would others say you're most passionate about? What convictions has God given you? How has God gifted you? And what do you want to accomplish in your relationships? How have you seen God use you to influence others? Just some questions to think about. Are you slothful? I don't think so. But are you passionate about the Church of Jesus Christ? I hope so.
Dedication is number 422. Please stand. Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Please be seated. May we unite our hearts in prayer. May we pray together. Be gracious, O Lord, and look upon your church this day throughout the world, guiding its search for the unity for which Jesus prayed. Gracious God, look upon the distress of those who are persecuted for their faith, those whose path ahead seems dim, those who are victims of oppressive relationships. Look upon the needy, that they may know the warmth of your faithfulness, that their hope may not be snuffed out like a candle flame. Be gracious, O Lord, and look upon those whom we name today in the silence of our own hearts, that in the darkness of their circumstance they may feel the gentle light of your presence. Gracious God, let your glory appear among us and make us sharers of your eternity with all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us all to pray, say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Dear God, we want to make the best use of our time on earth. We want to live our lives to your glory and as fully as possible. Therefore, we offer to you today our time, our energy, and our hearts. Accept them for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And everything we do is to say, grant us your support and guidance. In Jesus' name we pray.
We close the hymn this morning to hymn number 364. Now listen carefully to the good news. God goes ahead of you to be your guide. God is beside you to be your friend. God is behind you to encourage you. God is above and below you to sustain you. So wherever you are, and wherever you go in God's good creation, and whatever happens of good or of ill, remember that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior.